हेलो हेलो एवरीवन,
हे हाय स्वाति, हाउ आर यू? आई
या आई एम डूइंग गुड. करण, हाउ आर यू?
एम गुड टू. आई विल बी स्टार्टिंग इन अ फ्यू मिनट्स. अंटिल देन, इफ यू
ओके ओके
हैव एनी क्वेश्चंस देन यू कैन आस्क मी.
ओके या आई वांटेड, आई एम एक्सपेक्टिंग समथिंग लाइक रिगार्डिंग मोर इनटू टेक्स्ट अलाइनमेंट इन द फिग्मा.
टेक्स्ट अलाइनमेंट.
या टेक्स्ट अलाइनमेंट लाइक सपोज. या प्लीज गो अहेड.
Can you explain what exactly?
ओके, सो फर्स्ट इफ आई टेक एनी फ्रेम एंड इफ आई यूज हेडिंग एंड अंडर दैट इफ आई वांट टू यूज सब हेडिंग एंड द नॉर्मल टेक्स्ट और अ पैराग्राफ, सो हाउ मच
ओके.
लेंथ आई हैव टू लाइक लीव इट, आई मीन द गैप बिटवीन द हेडिंग, सब हेडिंग एंड द टेक्स्ट.
ओके, सो
So
दैट
how
इज
do
आई
we
थिंक.
calculate?
Okay, so for example, if you see this, right? If you see this page, are you able to see this frame, right?
No.
This frame, oh sorry, I have to present the screen.
Yeah.
Really sorry.
The screen isn't
Okay, I forgot that. Really sorry
shared
for
currently.
that. Let me show you how I do it. So I have a convention which I follow, wherein I give a spacing in the multiples of 8, or say in the multiples of 4. So if the text sizes are big, like in this frame, I try to give at least 16, gap of 16, and a gap of. So it depends on what elements you want to show together. So for example, I want to show these two things together. So I've given a spacing of 16, right? So I can also do with giving a spacing of 8 between them, so that they look that they are together and they are conveying one message. And between these two, since this is my main message and this is my say secondary message, or say not as important, I give a distance of 32 here. I can also give a distance of say 48. And if you are talking about text in your designs, so if I type in title here, you have to look at the size of the title first. For example, the size of my title is 16. Okay, I'll have to zoom in to show it to you. And if I duplicate it, and now my title size, subtitle size is 12. Okay, so in this, I can give like 4.
हेलो हेलो.
Give 4 my for distance of 4 between these two, right? And if my line height for both of these is 150% of my text size, so I can also give it a distance of 2 or 4. So it all depends on what your line height is and what elements you want to show together. So you can study how it is done in different systems. I can show you an example here. Here it is. Yeah, just a second. Let me search. So if you see, this is the material design UI kit. So this is the heading, and this is their info, if I can call it anything. This would be an additional info. But they haven't given any kind of gap between these two. Okay, so if you select both of these and see what gap is between them, it is in fact -1. All right, so you have to check what the line height is basically. So the line height is, say, the size of text is 24 and the line height is 28. All right, so you'll have to determine that based on your text size and line height. So there is no fixed convention for that, but if you have a fixed spacing system set for yourself, like if you give it in multiple of 4 or in multiple of 8, you can go with 2, 4, 8, and then you can go on to 16 and so on. So you need to have a spacing system set before you give any spacing, so that there's a uniformity in all the sizes that you give. Okay.
Got
Yeah,
it.
I
Thank
think
you.
we should. we'll be starting now,
Okay.
right? So I'll be turning on my video for a second. So
Okay.
hello everyone. Thank you so much for taking out the time to join today. And my name is Karan Kapoor, and I'm a freelance designer based in New Delhi. And today I have organized this Q&A session just to answer some of your questions. I was getting a lot of questions from you as to what, how to design, how to create a design system, how to create a design library. So I have compiled those answers in today's session, and I hope that I'm able to answer your questions. So I have a list of questions that I'll be referring to, and I have prepared an agenda based on the recurring questions. So I'll be moving, I'll be going forward with answering those recurring questions first, and then I'll be addressing each of your questions one by one. And right before we start, if you guys have attended any of my any of the previous sessions, I have compiled a list of, so this is a file where I have compiled a list of the animations and the resources that I used in my previous sessions. So if you click on this link that I just sent, this file would open for you. Okay, so I have this session where I described animation, and this whole animation was done, and also this whole animation is in this file. So all you have to do is that you have to click on this drop down and duplicate it to your drafts, okay, so that you can use it yourself, and you can experiment with this file, and you can also create your own designs based on what based on what parameters were used in this design and what interactions are used in this design. Okay, so I have put this link in the chat, and I'll soon be breaking down the videos from my previous sessions so they are watchable, and I will walk you through creating animations and components. Okay, so you can use this file to your heart's content, and you can show me what you are able to do with on top of the things that I have already done. All right, so I'm looking forward to you all experimenting with this file and sending me or sharing with me your designs or what you can do with the interactions and the animation basically. Okay, so now we'll be starting with the session. I'll turn my video off, and if you have any questions during the session, you can unmute yourself and just ask me. Otherwise, we'll address your questions towards the end. All right, so yeah, let's start. Okay, so welcome to this Figma Q&A session, and the first topic that I have for today is developer handoff. So this is a question that a lot of you submitted in the form. So I'll be going over very briefly over how you can smoothen the handoff process with your developer, since design is only valid or only successful when it is converted into real world software or real world interaction. And developers play an important role in that. So what my suggestion to you would be, whenever you have any icon in your design, always, and any image, always mark it for export. Okay, so what I mean by that is that if I have any image, so if I have this image and I click on it, and you can see on the right hand panel that there is an export button here. Okay, all you have to do is you have to click on export, and you have to select what format you want the developer to export this image or icon in. So if you're working with images, you can go with the option of JPG, PNG, and SVG if it is a vector file. Okay, and if you're working with icons, which I have used here, so if this is one of my icons, and if I want the developer to export it in a particular format, I'll always have to click on export, right? And then I would have to choose the format that the developer would export it in. So for Android and for web, you can choose SVG or JPG or PNG. And for iOS handoffs or for iOS icons, basically what you have to do is you have to export it in PDF. So if you mark it to be exported in PDF, the developer would be able to easily export it whenever they come onto your file. Okay, so this is one tip that I would give, and this feature is available in all the software Adobe XD, Adobe Sketch, and other softwares as well. So this really eases the process for developers to kind of come to a page and then export the assets basically. So image and icons are your assets, and you should always mark them for export whenever you use them anywhere. And the second thing would be whenever you I mean define a component or define any element which you define as a component, you should document it. So what I mean by documentation is, so if I have this heading and subheading pair, and if I define it as a component, right, so this is my parent component now. And if you go on to the right hand side, you'll see this description box. So what this description box is basically, it means that you can convey the ideas to your developers or to your team by writing what you thought about while making this design. And you can write about spacing. So I had a lot of questions from you guys that how to educate designers about spacing and how you created some components. So you can write your thoughts here. So in case your design, moves a little bit in a transition, or someone does something while collaborating. So if I have to give a spacing of 16 between these two elements, and it somehow moves to 12, so you can write here that spacing between elements is 16. Ignore any other spacing. Okay, and if you have a color palette set, you can also write what color is it for the heading color. You can write it primary, okay, and subheading color. You can write primary dark or primary light or whatever color palette you have chosen. All right. So this would explain the developers when they come to your components that, okay, even if it is a bit construed or bit, it is not as it was supposed to be. So they can refer to this description here. And they will be able to understand that even if it is moved by a little bit, or if it is shook by a little bit, they will be able to understand that this is what you intended to make it. Okay, so this is another great feature in Figma, that you can document your design or document your components rather when you make them. Right, so this is one tip. And another tip would be to, this is one of the most important or one of the most useful tips that I found, that whatever components or whatever icons you make, you have a separate page for them. So I have created the symbols page, right? I don't have a lot of things in it for now, but when I come on to my icons and I select any icon, for example, this account icon, and I name it as icon/account, right? And then I create a component out of it. If I click on this create component, it is a component now. So what I will need to do is, wherever I use this icon, I will have to mark it for export at all of those places. But that is not the right way to do it. So what you can do is, if you create an icon, you can move it to the symbols page. Okay. And then all the components that you create, you can move them to symbols page and then mark them for export here. So all the icons, all the components, all the images, you'll have at one place. So your developer or the people in your team wouldn't have to refer to 10 different pages or 10 different components to just export this icon. Okay, so for example, you forget to export, market as export somewhere. So they will know that this icon I can always find in this symbols page. Okay, so this is an important tip that you can follow while handing off your designs to your developers. Because design, if it is just kept inside a file, it is nothing. And it is only valid or it is only successful when it is actualized in the real world, or when people can interact with it. And people can interact with it only when the development is good or the development is smooth. So these are some ways in which you can smoothen out the handoff process for development. And this is these tips come from experience, that a lot of times the developers are not able to find the icons, find the images, so they most of their time is spent on finding the resources. So we should ease their process by having all our assets, all our icons, all our components at one page, so that they can refer to that one page every time they have to refer to the design. Right. So this is one tip. These are three tips that I have. I could not get your question, Vishwas. Can you unmute yourself and ask?
Hello, Karan. I don't have seen the link which you share in the message.
The Figma file.
Hello.
The Figma file link you are talking about. Okay. I'll send it again. I think you joined after I sent the link. Yeah. So here is the link, and when you come to this file, all you have to do is duplicate it to your draft, so that you have a separate copy of it. Okay. So yeah. Now moving on to what you can do to make the process even easier. So I came across a really good article where this spacing system was told in a very, very, very easy way. So if you see that, this is a screen that I have designed. This is a very, very raw screen, and it almost looks like it is almost close to a wireframe. So this is a screen, and these are some images, okay? So now when you have to give it to developer, and if the spacing gets construed by some other designer or in the midst of handing it off, what you can do is, you can have one such screen where you can have the same elements but in terms of boxes. So what this would help you in is that you can create a box of the minimum spacing that you will have between elements. So for example, I have minimum spacing of 8 between my elements. You can create a box of 8x8. And when you give it to developers and you give a wireframe to your developers, basically, they can understand by the number of boxes there are between the elements to kind of understand that what spacing is to be there between these elements. So if the developer knows that this box means spacing of 8, so they will automatically be able to know that two boxes mean a spacing of 16 and one box means spacing of 8 and so on. So you can do this if you want to make the development process even smoother, and you want your developers to understand what your thought process was while designing the screen. So you can create this 8x8 square, and you can use it everywhere you want, and to show the spacing between certain elements. So if I have to show it between these two, so for now it is 48, right? So I will be showing it like this. Okay, so this is how I would show it. And if you have to make it easier, you can also make it in one such way that it is easier to calculate the number of boxes. Okay, so I am easily able to calculate the number of boxes. I'll not have to go to the design and always see how much spacing is there from each end. So this is another good way that you can ease off the development process. Okay. And these are my thoughts about development handoff. And if you have any questions, so feel free to ask me right now. And I'll be moving on to the next topic, which is the design library. Okay, so I think there are no questions for this. So I'll be moving on to the next. So the next question that a lot of you asked was about the design system. Okay, so before starting what a design system is, I'll tell you how it helps you in designing faster. So this is the material design library, all right? It has all the components that you need to design any app. So this is a design library, basically, and it is a design system of Google, all right? And if you want to use it in your designs, all you have to do is I'm dropping this link in the chat, and you will have to just go to this link and open the material theming kit in Figma, and the same file that I'm using would be open for you. So I'll show you how you can leverage the power of a design system. So this is a wireframe that I have created. It is very rough, very, very rough wireframe. And I have written the names of the components that I'll be using in it. Okay. So all you have to do is write the names of the components that you'll be using. And then that is where the real magic begins. Okay. So I have written status bar for now. I go on to my assets and I type in status bar. I don't know what the naming is for the Android material design. It is system bar. Okay. So the system bar appears and I drag and drop it here. So this part is done. Now I have my navigation bar. All right. So let me see where it is. So I am not able to find it right now, but I'll be moving on to my bottom navigation, which I have easily found. So I will see that I need three icons of home, saved and account. So I'll use the three icon navigation bar here. So the bottom part of it is also done. All right. And now I'll be using these two cards. So I am using two buttons inside my card. I'll look for which card has two buttons. All right. So I think this card has two buttons inside it. Just a second. I can use this card, for example. All right. And then I'll duplicate it and duplicate it again to create a carousel kind of a thing. Okay. So I have most of my elements in place now. So now all that is left is my top bar, or so I have found it here. Okay, yeah, thank you, Nitin. Yeah, so this is my top bar, or my navigation bar, or as Nitin said, app bar. Okay, so this, I have placed these elements here. And now my wireframe has automatically converted into my actual design. So this is how components and design systems will help you in thinking more about more about what you are showing and less about how you are showing them. So your components would already be in place, and all you would have to do is come to this assets panel and duplicate them. All right. So a lot of part about thinking about the visual language and the visual design of a component would be eliminated just by using the component library. So you can think more about how you can make the experience better, and how you can make screens and prototype better. All right. So this is how these components will help you in designing. And if you want, then I am dropping a link for the Notion doc that I have compiled with some resources and some design libraries. Okay. And if you want to use any other design library, you can search for design libraries in Sketch, and then you can import it in Figma, because there are not a lot of design libraries right now for Figma, and that is how you can leverage the power of design libraries. Okay, so now on to creating a design library of your own. Okay, so first of all, I'll be busting some myths about design system. I'll go on over them very quickly. So design system is not a one-off job or task that or a side project. It needs a dedicated team to create it and a full-time effort of a team. All right, and it is it doesn't limit your creative freedom. It in fact helps you think about experience more, and it helps you think about how you can make the existing experience of the user better, and not thinking about the colors, the text sizes and everything like that. And the design system is not just a collection of components. It is a collection of a lot of things. It is a collection of documentation. It is a collection of the visual language, the voice and tone that you will use for your project or product, that you convey to the user that it is welcoming or it is very professional, and so on. And another myth is that it is all encompassing, that if you create one design system, you can create everything with it. So it is not at all true. The design system is very specific to your product and to your design. And one of the all encompassing design systems is material design. It has components for, I mean, most of the needs for your design. So I would suggest that you start with this design system if you have to understand how design systems work. And these are some of the myths that we have about design systems. And these are some of the truths that are just opposite of the myth. All right. So, and these are some of the components of a design system that I just mentioned. Okay, so I think I will now be moving on to one, the part that a lot of people are interested in, which is a component library. So let me first show you this diagram. Okay, so I'll be looking at the chat and asking you one question about this diagram, that how many times have you seen this diagram while reading about design systems or component libraries? If you have come across one such diagram, just leave a yes in the chat, so I'll be able to understand your understanding of this type of designing. Okay, so Saptarshi says that he has come across it. I think that most of you must have come across it while studying about design systems and components library in general. Okay, so how many of you actually understand it basically? How many of you understand by just looking at the diagram what it is? So if you know, then write a yes. If you don't, then write a no. Okay. Yeah, so this is a very big gap between seeing that diagram and actually utilizing it in your own design process. So I'll be walking you through a very, very basic process in which you can set your own library. Okay, so first of all, let us read what is written here. So this is written, it is written that there is an atom first, then there are molecules, and there is an organism. So what it really means is that textiles, colors, icon, shadow, border, you should lay them down at first before starting any design library project. Okay, so what it really means is, I'll show you how. Okay, so these are my colors. All right. So I am naming these colors first. I am creating color styles or color palette out of them. So I'll click on any color, any element that has color, and then I'll be going on to this menu and adding this color, say as primary color, and say it is the light variant of my primary color. Okay. So now I have this color in place. All right, I'll be deleting all of these other styles so there's no confusion. Okay, so this is my primary color, and say this is my secondary color. I'll be naming this color as secondary slash light. Okay, so this is my secondary light color, and I'll be naming this color to tertiary slash light. Okay, so this is my color style. So you can refer to design libraries such that the material design library that we have here, and you can see how they have named their colors. Okay, and you can take cues from other libraries as well. And there is a great article that I have in the Notion doc, which is a reapproaching color by the Lyft design team. Okay, so you can read it, and you can choose whichever method you want to name your colors. Okay, so I'll be dropping this in the chat. It is also in the Notion doc that I shared. So now that you have named your colors, now comes the textiles. So when you look at any other design library like material design, it has a plethora of textiles here, and every textile has some properties associated with it, and it has a name, and the name is not associated with the size of the text. All right. So for example, in future you have to change your heading text to not 96, and say you have to change it to 80. So you will not name it as size 80 slash Roboto light. So you will be naming it H1, so that every time this changes to 80, you will not have to change it here, right? So you will not have to change it to 80 at every place that you have used it. Okay, so I'll be creating a textile out of this. So the textile, the naming convention that I follow is the size is 48, right? So I create it as text slash, and if say if the size is 48, I will name it in a certain manner. Text slash. So you can all, I follow this convention of the Zomato design system, wherein you have, they have divided their text styles into regular, medium, semi-bold, and then they have named it according to the sizes. So they have named it 900, 800, 700, and so on. So what I do is I name it as text slash 900 slash, this font doesn't have any weight, so I will name it bold for now. Okay. All right. So this is how I will name it, and you can always go and edit it. And wherever you have used this textile, right? Wherever you have used this textile of text slash 900 slash bold, every time you change it, it automatically changes wherever I have used this textile. And you can look at this Zomato's, you can take the reference of Zomato in naming your textile. So I use this convention where I have text slash 900 slash bold. So what this helps in is that all your textiles, when you have to choose from the drop down here, you'll see that text slash bold is my dividing point, and all the sizes that I have inside will have my text sizes divided according to their hierarchy. And a great thing that Figma has just announced is that they also show you text size and the line height percentage. So when I look at this this text size, I would know that this is 900 and the size is 24 and the line height is 150% of my text size. So this is a great new feature in Figma. All right. So now I am done with my textiles. And now coming on to my icon. So this is my icon. I will name this icon by double clicking on it in the layer. And I'll name it as icon slash account. And make sure that all the icons that you name from this point onwards would have the same convention of icon slash and then the name of the icon. And now I create a component out of it. Okay. And now I'll be creating, based on these three elements, a text field. So you'll understand how to make things scalable. So this is my text style. I'll copy it. And I can also write my own text here. I can write title and then attach it to one of my text styles. So for now it is attached to this 900. I can also attach it to 600. I can also attach it to 800 or whatever I want. All right. So this is how you would do it. You have placed this textile, you have given this text a textile. Now you would use this icon inside this text field. So you have made a copy of this icon. This is the parent and this is the child. Okay, so I'm giving it a spacing of 24 from the left, and the spacing between these two, title and icon, is 16. Okay, so now we are set with these three elements, and now I'll grab these three elements and then create one single component out of it and name it to my text field. All right, and now let us go back and also give this text field this background a color. So if I go on to my fill, I'll be attaching it to this color. All right, and then I can increase the stroke width, and then I will create a component out of this whole selection. Just a second. I will create a component, a single component, and then I'll name it text field slash whatever variant you want to name it. So I will name it variant 1. Okay, so this is done now. So now these are all my components, my base component set, and this is my a combination of these all base components. Okay, so now as you have seen here, the color, the textile, and the icon are my atoms, and when I combine them together, they form a molecule. So this is a molecule, basically a text field. So now this is a parent component. I'll be duplicating this to this frame and making a copy of it. And now whenever I change anything anywhere, so if I change the size of this text in the text styles, it will change everywhere that I have used this text. And if I change anything inside this icon, for example, I move, I remove this inside hollow circle. So it will automatically update everywhere. And when you come to this icon, you will see that the similar elements are listed with this icon. So if you would have, so let me show it to you in material design. So if you click on this icon and you go on to master component and you go over to icon, all the icons that you have are listed in this format. So how this naming works is they have named it as master components and then master component slash icon slash favorite slash fill. So this is how you should name your components assets so that they are easily accessible and they are easily switchable. And you can also use certain states of your components, which I'll be getting over to in just a second. So this is how you will name your states. So I go over to master component, go over to fab, the floating action button, and these are the variants and in the various sizes, and these are the various states. So this, so all you have to do is name your components according to this file system format, wherein you name it as master component slash fab slash extended slash enabled focus hover press and so on. So you have to follow a naming convention to name your components. So this is a very scalable naming convention that is followed in the industry, and you can also check it at material design kit that I just shared with you. And you can also see how other companies are naming their naming it in their design, and this is an example of Zomato's design system, and you can see how they have named it and how they have separated all the states basically. Alright, so you can take cues from how they are combining smaller elements and then making bigger elements out of them. Okay, so this is so now we have our molecules, right? And now this, if I say that this is my molecule, so this whole screen is an organism which is listed here as an organism. And when I create a template out of these screens, like if I have a form and I want these three text fields to be in every screen of the form that I have, so that would create a template. So I would just have to repeat this template and I would be able to use it at a lot of places. Okay, and then you can create features out of those templates basically. Okay, so this is how you would create, you would have your color set first, then your text styles, then your icon, and then you will combine all of these three and then create a component. And if I edit this color now, if I edit this color to anything else, it would automatically update at all the places that I have used it at, as you might be able to see. So this is how powerful creating a component system for yourself is. And now coming back to the some points that I wrote about components library, that this is one of the most important points, that everything has a source. Okay, so there is no arguing about the fact that you are designing for a single screen. You are designing for a system instead of a screen. So you'll have to broaden your perspective when you're designing anything and be very careful about what you define as a component and what you don't. So when you define a component, it should be reusable, it should be scalable, and it should link back to something. And which is this point over here, that everything has a source, and you have to think about a system rather than a screen. So if you create a screen and you find that this element can be used in other screens also, so create a component out of it and then reuse it so that it can be changed all at once, and you don't have to worry about changing 10 other screens. Okay, so Ritika says that what if we have to edit a component in just a particular screen without affecting other screens? So yeah, so that is my next point, that this is the parent, which will be indicated by this filled square there, and these are your child or instances of this component. So you can change anything in this component. So let me show you how. So when I click on this component, I have this primary color light. I can change this color to say tertiary light color without affecting the parent, and I can change this to my secondary color without affecting the parent or all other components. But one thing you have to keep in mind is that when you change anything in this component, only in one component or instance, right? And you make change in the parent after that. So what would happen is, whatever property you change in one particular component, right? Say I change the color in this, so they would not be linked back to my parent anymore. I will have to click on this component and then reset, or I would have to reset any overrides that I have. Only then you would be able to handle it from here. Otherwise, any change that you make to your instance or your child components would stay only in that instance or only in that child. So this, and if I even change the text style here to 16 or to say 700, it wouldn't change in all the other components, only this component. And now you can also change this icon here, wherein I can use any other icon here. I didn't have any other icon, so I replaced it with a button. Okay, so this is how you can adjust the parameters in your child. And you can also, if you want, that all the changes that you have made to your component in one of its instances, and if you want to push those changes back to your parent, you can push those overrides to your master, and all the instances would be updated according to the master if they have the same properties, and if they have not, if you have not edited any of the properties from it. So I think that answers your question. Great question. So we cannot actually change the position of our elements in our component. But what we can do is we can make it very flexible. So for example, I have this component and I am detaching it from, so let me make a fresh component for you and let me show it to you how. So if I have this card and I have this type, if I write something here, all right, and now if I write subtitle here, all right, and now if I select both of these and if I give it an auto layout and set a spacing between them, say of 12, and then I combine these three and give it an auto layout again and give it a spacing of 8. Okay, so and now if I define it as a component and reuse it somewhere else, so now whenever you increase, you will not be able to change the sizes of these elements. But what you can do is, if you change the text style inside it, and if you change this also, so this would all automatically adjust to that size. So you can give it an auto layout, which is a flexi layout basically. And you can change the overall height or overall width. And so this is, components are supposed to be very, not very rigid, but very firm, and so that you can use them freely across your designs. So I think, Nitin, that answers your question. Okay. So these are some questions that I got from you guys, and I tried to present them in an explainable or an understandable form. So if you have any other questions, then you can unmute yourself and ask me right now. All right. So now I also received a few questions about how we can leverage shortcuts to kind of make our workflow faster, right? So I have created a list of some shortcuts here. All right, so this is a list of shortcuts that I created. I will go over some of them, right? So some of them are very generic or basic that you can get to know. So this is our layers, this is used for layers. So if you see that this control, this layer on the left hand side is below. So I want to move it above in the layers panel, all I would click on is control and my right side square bracket key. And if I have to move it below in the layers panel, I would have to click on control and left side bracket key. And now if I have to move it to the top of the layer hierarchy, I will hold down shift and then click on my right side square bracket. And if I have to move it at the bottom of my layers hierarchy, I'll have to click on control, shift, and left side left side square bracket. And if I have to duplicate any element or create a copy on top of it, I'll have to click on Control D. So as you can see, this Control D layer is just one in number. If I click on Control D, it increases in number like so. And when you click on Control D, for example, here I will show you how you can use it. So if I click on Control D, right, if I am duplicating this element and if I leave it anywhere, so whatever spacing is between these two elements, and then I can click on Control D and keep clicking on it, the elements would come at the same spacing below the next element. So this is a great shortcut that you can use. All right. This is the duplicate shortcut. And if you want to create a component out of your selection, you can click on Control Alt and K, or you can just click on this icon here, create component, and a component would be created. And if you want to detach any child component from its parent, for example, this is my parent component and this is my child component. And if I want to detach it from my parent, all I have to do is click on Control Alt and B. So it would be detached. As you can see that it doesn't show the empty square icon here anymore. So this is a quick shortcut if you want to detach your instance from your parent. And then is the reducing and increasing the text size. So I can do it by holding on to my, so this is actually, this is not Control Alt, this is Control and Shift. So I will click on Control and Shift, and then I had a duplicate behind it. I'll click on Control Shift and left side triangular bracket, or okay, left side, and for right side it would increase by 1 point every time I click on it. And there's a distinction between frames and groups in Figma. So if you click on Control and G, it would create a group out of your selection, and if you click on Control Alt and G, it would create a frame. So frames and groups work differently in Figma, and this is a way to create your frames. And if you want to rename your layer, your group, or a frame, all you have to do is click on that frame or your layer or your group and simply click on Control R, and it would open the renaming option. I can rename it to shortcuts. All right. And if you want this list of shortcuts, then you can mail me. I will send it to you separately. I'll have to convert it to PDF for now. Okay, so I'll send it to you separately if you want a copy of this. And the next one would be Control Alt and C or V. So if you click on Control Alt and C or V, so if I reduce the text size of it to 14. Okay, so now if I click on Control Alt and C, it would copy all the properties it has, like text size, color, and everything else. And now if I click on this text and click on Control Alt V, it would have the same color, the same alignment, the same, all the same properties copied to this. So it would not only copy the text or the layer, it would copy the properties inside it also. All right. So this is another great shortcut that you can use. And the other shortcut is Shift plus H. So what this does is if I click on it, it would horizontally flip my group layer, or let me check it with my frame if it works. Oh, I think no, it doesn't work with my frames. All right, so you can flip any group or your, so this one is a group. If I click on Shift H, you can, it can automatically flip the group or my element or my layer. And this is another shortcut, which is Shift plus V, which you can use to flip it vertically. Let me zoom out and show it to you. Now all the elements are flipped vertically, right? And after that, if you have to edit any, yeah, so this is a great shortcut. So if you are in any group or any frame, and if you want to go inside it, all you have to do is click on Enter and it would open the group for you. And if you want to close it, all you have to do is click on Shift and Enter, and it would close the group automatically, or it would direct you to the parent of the element that element is in. So Shift Enter is to address the parent, all right? And then there is Shift A. So Shift A is basically to create an auto layout out of your selection. So if I click on Shift A, it would automatically create an auto layout. It is all messed up right now, so I'll not be so when you like I created it here in my card instead of so I'm detaching it from my parent by Control Alt V, and then if I want to kind of if I am also changing this, I if I want to have like an auto layout of the spacing between these two, I will select this and then I will click on Shift and A, so it would automatically convert to auto layout, and I can give it padding on the left and right and top and bottom. Right, so this is how you can group or you can give an auto layout to your elements. Okay, and now another great tip is if you click on any number, say 1, 2, or you click on two numbers in succession, such as 1, 2, 2, 3, and so on, so it would change the opacity of that particular element or layer or group. So if you click on this, for now, I have clicked on 1, so it has changed the opacity of this layer to 10%. And if I click on 2, it would change it to 3, it would change 30%. And now if I click on 4, 5 in succession, it would change to 45%. Okay. And another shortcut is Control Alt M. If you have any layer behind any element, and if you want to use that layer as a mask for all these elements, so let me show it to you. I have created this rectangle and I'm moving it to bottom of this art frame. And if I want to use this rectangle as my mask for all the elements above it, all I have to do is click on Control Alt and M. So now wherever this rectangle was, it has created like a selection or a boundary around that rectangle. So if you want to show certain elements and if you want to constrict them, then you can use a mask. All right. So these are some shortcuts. And then another one is that if you resize your parent component, so I'm increasing the spacing between them, and then if you go on to your child component instance, you would see that it is coming outside of this parent boundary. So what it basically means is that when you edit it, you have to click on this shortcut here, which is resize to fit. So whenever you make any changes to your component, make sure you select this so that your child component or your parent component doesn't exceed the boundaries of your kind of frame. So what it does is it causes a lot of problems when you are spacing. So it takes the spacing from this boundary and not from this end of this child. So if you have to work, you'll have to be vigilant about this, that you always click on this fit to content so that your components don't have any issues, right? And the next thing would be alignment. So if you click on any two layers, groups and things like that, and if you want to align them vertically or horizontally rather, so you can click on them and you can click on this shortcut, they would be aligned horizontally. And if you have to align them to their left side or to the right side or to the top of each other or to the bottom of each other, you can use these use this trick to do that. All right, so yeah, these are some of the questions that I have taken from here. And if you have any other questions from what I have just addressed, please feel free to ask me right now, or you can also reach out to me over LinkedIn, or you can also reach out to me over Instagram, where I post about these events. All right, so yeah, if you have any questions, then please feel free to ask them. Okay, Nitin is asking me about how we can use auto layout. Okay, Nitin, so you can use auto layout when you are using such components, right? So let me show it to you how we'll use this. I have created this component, right? And if I select these two elements inside it and I give it an auto layout, I think it is already in auto layout. So now my spacing between these two elements is fixed. Okay. And I am increasing this boundary of this subtitle to be equal to my card layout. Okay. So now what will happen is whenever I whenever I type a long sentence inside this, say inside any of my child components. So this is a dummy card. It doesn't have content inside it. So whenever I type inside it anything, title is the first line of text. Yeah, I'll have to limit this basically. I'll have to limit this also to my end of my card. This is the first line of text in my component. Okay, and subtitle is the second line, which is longer. So as you can see that as soon as my text exceeded this boundary and it moved to the next line, this subtitle automatically moved below. And another example that I can show you is why you should use it is, if I now keep it out of my auto layout, so I am removing the auto layout from these two elements from the parent. Now that I've done that, you can see that my subtitle subtitle has moved to the place where it is on its place, but the title has increased in lines. So it hasn't shifted, the subtitle hasn't moved automatically down. Okay, so that is one use case of where you should use auto layout when you have layers of text or you have layers of elements that you want to maintain the spacing between. So is it clear to you, Nitin? Yeah, okay, thank you. So yeah, now if you people have any other questions, I'll be addressing them now, and otherwise we'll be ending this session right here. And you can always so I'm dropping the links for a final time here. Okay, so these are some links that you can refer to that I have been sending in this session all along. And you can reach out to me on LinkedIn, you can reach out to me on Instagram. I post about these events over there. And you can also give me feedback about what you think can be improved and what I should take in the next sessions. Yeah, thank you, Ritika. Thank you, Swati. And yeah, about that PDF of shortcuts, just leave me a mail or reply to the mail, invite mail that I sent you. I'll send that PDF to you. Otherwise, it could take a bit of time for me to export it and then send it to you. Yeah, thanks, Ayush. Yeah, so you can go ahead and try these things and you can reach back to me with your own designs, and you can use the file, the Figma file that I shared with you basically. Okay. Yeah, I'll love to hear back from you and see what you guys are doing. So yeah, thank you so much for attending this session. Thank you for being a regular attendee, all those who attend regularly, and thank you for coming for the first time. I hope that you come for the next sessions as well. And thank you so much. I'll see you next time, and I'll announce the next session in a short while. Thank you so much. Have a good night.